There's a lot of scripture to cover tonight, so there's no intro, there are no jokes. There's no bit of wisdom from this mortal man, but only God's word. We're going to be in Mark chapter 15, verses 22 through 39, and you can turn there in your Bibles. Now, if there's a pew Bible in front of you, if you don't have a Bible, take that with you when you leave, it's yours. Mark 15, verses 22 through 39. This is the word of God. And they brought him to the place called Golgotha, which means place of a skull. And they offered him wine mixed with myrrh, and he did not take it. And they crucified him and divided his garments among them, casting lots for them to decide what each should take. And it was the third hour when they crucified him. And the inscription of the charge against him read, "The King of the Jews." And with him they crucified two robbers, one on his right and one on his left. And those who passed by derided him, wagging their heads and saying, "Ah, you who would destroy the temple and rebuild it in 3 days, save yourself. Come down from the cross." So also the chief priests with the scribes mocked him to one another, saying, "He saved others, he cannot save himself. Let the Christ, the King of Israel, come down now from the cross, that we might see and believe." Those who were crucified with him also reviled him. And when the sixth hour had come, there was darkness over the whole land until the ninth hour. And at the ninth hour, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, "Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" And some of the bystanders, hearing it, said, "Behold, he's calling to Elijah." And someone ran and filled the sponge with sour wine, put it on a reed, and gave it to him to drink, saying, "Wait, let us see whether Elijah will come to take him down." And Jesus uttered a loud cry and breathed his last. And the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. And when the centurion who stood facing him saw that in this way he breathed his last, he said, "Truly, this man was the Son of God." This is the word of God. Let's pray. Father, grant us wisdom to understand what we see in the text and feel in our hearts in this most perplexing and upsetting passage. Show us your joy in a recounting of the agony and death of your only Son. Help your children to understand the blessing in the hearing of the blaspheming of your Son and our Redeemer. Such wisdom and understanding is not available in my weak and mortal mind, but only through guidance and counsel of your Holy Spirit. So in Jesus' name we ask, the Spirit will speak to us now from your holy book. Amen. Would it surprise you guys if I told you that this scripture is not about physical pain and suffering? It's a message that I've preached myself I don't know how many times, and I've heard others preach it I don't know how many times either, that Jesus underwent this incredible suffering and pain. He did it for us, therefore he must love us more than any other man could have loved us. But that is not the point of this scripture. As a matter of fact, strictly speaking, it's not even true. You see, if that were true, there are thousands upon thousands of people who could claim to love us just as much. Jesus is not the only man who was tortured to death by crucifixion. This form of slow and painful execution was used for 1,000 years. By the Carthaginians and the Romans from 6th century BC to 4th century AD. All those thousands upon thousands of people experienced the same shame and abuse and pain that Jesus' body felt. So realize, no matter how bad it was, and it was bad, others had experienced it too. Now, the significant thing here in this text is the difference in Jesus. It's the difference of Jesus. It is the difference that Jesus makes, because it is he who is being crucified here. Let's examine just 3 points in the scripture. 3 points that I think will clarify this for us. A, Jesus is the Son of God. B, Jesus was denied by his creation, by the very people he came to save. And C, Jesus took upon himself all the sins of mankind, all of your sins, all of my sins, all the sins of every man and woman who ever walked this planet. Yes, there was certainly physical pain in crucifixion, all crucifixion, but there was spiritual pain in the crucifixion of Jesus, pain in his spirit, pain in his heart of hearts, not the physical heart that beats within us, but the heart that we have when we understand God and when we know Jesus Christ. He had that heart, and that's where his suffering took place. That was the pain of Jesus' crucifixion that wasn't felt by all those other thousands, maybe even millions of people. And yet he did it. God put him through this. He readily walked, willingly walked to the cross and felt the punishment, felt the anger of the creator of the universe on the creator of the universe for his own purpose, for his own honor, for his own glory, and for our salvation. A, Jesus is the Son of God. If that man hanging on that cross 2,000 years ago was not the Son of God, not the long-awaited Messiah, not the promised Son, a Savior of the world, none of the rest of his crucifixion would mean much more to us than that of those other thousands of poor, hapless people, human beings who were condemned to this same excruciating pain and suffering. Sad? Yes. Horrific? Yes. Disgusting? Yes. But irrelevant to our faith and trust in God. So what can we learn through the crucifixion account here in Mark about the deity of God? Is Jesus the Son of God, the Messiah, the expected one, the promised one? Let's look quickly at just 3 places in the Gospel of Mark pointing directly to Jesus as the Messiah. First, Mark 15, 22 says, "And they brought him to the place called Golgotha, which means place of the skull." Do you see it there? They brought him. He didn't fight. He didn't put up any resistance at all. As a matter of fact, we remember back to the passages right before this that Jesus never even offered any defense of himself in his mock trial when lie after lie was foisted upon him. Hundreds of years before this happened, Scripture had predicted that the Messiah would experience exactly this event and handle it in this same very unusual, very unnatural way. Isaiah 53:7 says, "He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth, like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, like a sheep that is silent before its shearer. So he did not open his mouth." I ask you, would any man do that? Would any human being do it that way? All Jesus, the man, had to do was deny his godship. Just say, "Oh, you know, I was joking. Oh, I didn't say those things. Oh, you misunderstood me." And they never would have even brought the charges against him in the first place. But he couldn't do that. He was God. He is God. He was the Messiah. And he couldn't deny it. Truly, this man, Jesus, was the Son of God. Second, in verse 24 of Mark 15, "And they crucified him." Real short, to the point. King David described this crucifixion of the Messiah, again the Messiah, in Psalm 22, 16 and 17. He said, "For dogs have surrounded me, a band of evildoers have encompassed me. They pierced my hands and my feet. I can count all my bones. They look, they stare at me." Stop and think about it. When David wrote these inspired words from God down on parchment, he was describing the way not Jesus would die. He didn't know the name of Jesus. It was the way the Messiah would die. He described crucifixion to a T, and yet, when he wrote this, The first death by crucifixion, the invention of crucifixion, was still hundreds of years in his future. And Jesus' death on the cross, another 600 years after that. Yeah, truly, this man Jesus was the Son of God. The third thing, as we read on in Mark, verse 24, and they crucified him and divided the garments among them, casting lots for them to decide what each should take. If we read a little bit farther in that very same Psalm 22 from David, he goes on in verse 18 to say, they divided my garments among them, and for my clothing they cast lots. The Messiah he's talking about, does Jesus not fit this bill? And there are thousands, well, hundreds, of other scriptural references to the Messiah, but these are all right here in Mark. They tell us that he is the Son of God. We have the proof of it from God's holy and inerrant word that Jesus is the Son of God, the long-awaited Messiah. There could be no doubt. So now B, we see that the Son of God, the Messiah, the Savior of the world, is being rejected by the very people that he came to save, which is every man, woman, and child in the world. But these right here with him around the cross on this fateful day. You remember what John 3:16 says? I think this is the first verse everybody memorizes, isn't it? For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. That's what the Messiah came for. That's what the Son of God came for. Yet Mark leads us through a litany of blasphemies hurled at the Son of God in rejection of his person and his power to save. Verse 26, from the very men whom God had trusted with his holy word, with his scriptures, with his law, and the inscription of the charge against him read, the King of the Jews. There was a sign over him that said, the King of the Jews. Now, at first glance, we might say, well, what's wrong with that? As a matter of fact, ironically, this inscription proclaims the Lord's rightful kingship, and majesty. But that wasn't the way they meant it. They meant it to be a slur upon him. We know from the Gospel of John that the leaders of God's people wanted it to be so. John 19:21 says, so the chief priests of the Jews said to Pilate, do not write the King of the Jews, but rather, this man said, I am King of the Jews. I am. And he proclaimed himself as God. That was blasphemy to them, and so they condemned him to death. And yet, do we not see the real blasphemy there? Since Jesus is, we've already proven it, the King of the Jews, their accusations against Jesus are in and of themselves blasphemy. And these guys aren't through yet, these religious men, these leaders of God's chosen people, men who know the scriptures backwards and forwards and should recognize at a moment's notice, at a glance, the personification of God's scripture. They're not finished. In Mark 15, 31 and 32, so also the chief priests with the scribes mocked him to one another, saying, he saved others, he cannot save himself. Let the Christ, the King of Israel, come down now from the cross that we may see and believe. They have been told the truth. They have heard the gospel, and they have rejected it. They have seen the Son of God, and they have not believed. Second, came passersby, onlookers from the population at large. Look in verse 29. And those who passed by derided him, wagging their heads and saying, ah, you who would destroy the temple and rebuild it in 3 days, save yourself. Come down from the cross. If these are not just passers-by who are denying Jesus as their Savior. No way. These are people who have heard about Jesus, have heard about his teachings, have heard about what he stands for and what he believes and his love for God. He never did anything that was an exception to the scriptures. They had heard all of this, and they're quoting right now the very words that Jesus spoke to them at the temple and on the mountaintop and from the bow of a boat in the Sea of Tiberias, in the home of Mark, and along the roads all over the region for maybe three and a half years. They have been told the truth, and they are rejecting it. They have seen the Son of God, and they have not believed either. And third, Jesus is rejected by two men who are guilty, as we might say, as guilty as sin. They're certainly guilty of their sins. In verse 32, we're told, those who were crucified with him also reviled him. Here are two men who have heard of Jesus, who have heard his claims to be the Messiah. They are criminals. They are in the last moments of their lives facing the same punishment that Jesus is facing, and they come face to face with the Son of God. Their redemption is as close as I am to you. Their salvation could be reached out and touched had they not been nailed or tied to a tree. And yet they blaspheme him. But look what happens next. This is a great message. It's kind of almost an aside, but it's what this whole thing is really ultimately about. Look what happens here. Well, we can't see it in Mark's gospel. Let's turn to Luke's gospel about this same event. In Luke 23, verses 39 through 43, we get the same instance being told about, being described, but by a different person, by Dr. Luke. And he tells us in 23, 39 through 43, one of the criminals who was hanged railed at him, at Jesus, saying, "Are you not the Christ? Save yourself and us." But the other rebuked him, saying, "Do you not fear God, since you are under the same sentence of condemnation? And we indeed justly, for we are receiving the due reward of our deeds. But this man has done nothing wrong." And he said, "Jesus." I don't know where he got the courage. It's Jesus. "Remember me when you come into your kingdom." And Jesus said to him, "Truly, I say to you, today, you will be with me in paradise." This man, this guilty man, repents of his sins, believes in Jesus, and though he has performed not one single good work, though he has not been sprinkled or dunked or baptized in any way, he has been saved. He has been redeemed. He has been pronounced righteous through the blood of Jesus Christ completely and immediately, right there on the spot by the Son of Jesus Christ. And he can do that for us. He will do that for us. He offers that to us. If only the others around Jesus had seen and realized, had seen and believed and had done the same thing. If only all of those around us would do it. All their, our blasphemy, all their torture, our torture, all ours, theirs, sins would have been forgiven too, will be forgiven too, if there's a breath left in our bodies. This one sinner turned from his sins, believed in the truth, the Son of God, and was granted salvation and eternal life right there on the spot. Didn't have to do anything, couldn't do anything. John 3:16, what did it say? "For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life." Even a sinner on a cross. A, Jesus is the Son of God, the Messiah, the long-awaited promised Savior of the world. B, Jesus was rejected by the very people he came to save. And C, Jesus took upon himself the sins of mankind. Mark 15, 33. It's going to be hard to see it here. We'll have to look elsewhere. And when the sixth hour had come, there was darkness over the whole land until the ninth hour. Mark doesn't give us a lot of information to go on here about what's going on with Jesus and with God at that time. However, it is extremely important to note something here, that of the seven times that Jesus spoke to us while on the cross, which is related to us in the four different Gospels, of those seven times, not one of those occurred from the sixth to the ninth hour during that three-hour period. He fell silent. The earth turned black. Something was going on. Something, if we look at all the scripture together, something that had to happen before he could leave, before he could die, before he finished his mission from God, as the Blues Brothers would say. He was on a mission from God, and he hadn't finished it yet. And he only has 3 hours left to do it before he's going to give up his spirit. So what happened during those 3 hours? What's going on? I think that Jesus was doing what he came to do. I think Paul says it very succinctly in 1 Corinthians 15:3 when he says, "For I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received," here it is, "that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the Scripture." During this three-hour period, he did what he came to do. He died for our sins in accordance with the Scripture. Well, that's more than a physical death. Let's look and see what the Scripture says. Let's go back to Isaiah 53, this time verses 5 and 6. Isaiah tells us about the Messiah, "But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities." You heard it just a moment ago. "Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace. And with his stripes, we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned every one to his own way. And the Lord has laid on Jesus, on him, the iniquity of us all." The Lord has laid his iniquity, his wrath, his punishment on Christ because we have all turned away. We have all gone astray. We have all sinned against God. Upon Jesus, God put his chastisement, his punishment, the punishment due us. Chastisement, which the Scripture says, brought us peace. The Scripture says, by his, Jesus' stripes, punishment that we were due, we are healed. But why Jesus? Why the Son of God? Why not those of us who have done the sinning? Jesus never sinned. It's our debt. But our righteous and holy Father has been sinned against, and by his nature, he cannot settle for anything less than perfect atonement. We, though he loves us completely, cannot be in his holy presence unless we first atone for all of our sins. But we can't do that. You probably know why, but I'm going to tell you anyway. Because a perfect blood sacrifice had to be made. Man has sinned against God, and man must ultimately atone for that wrong. A perfect lamb was just a stopgap, a temporary effort under the law. It was a shadow of the real thing, a type of the real sacrifice. And it was never meant to be the once for all, the once for eternity final sacrifice. The real thing, the final sacrifice, must be a perfect man, because it was man who sinned, who atones for each and every man's sin. Well, there was only one who could pay this debt and atone once and for all men. It's not you. It's not me. It wasn't any of those men standing around the cross or any man who's ever walked the earth, because none of us are perfect. It had to be the man God. That's Jesus. A holy man WH. Holy man. Holy God. Holy sinless. No sin at all. So as this sixth hour begins, the Son of Man becomes completely silent. And he begins the all but unbearable chastisement for our sins, the hands of a righteous and holy God. I believe God was right there. He had to be. He was dispensing on his precious child the punishment meant for you and me. God was presiding over the payment of the debt owed to him. That debt was pain and suffering of hell for an eternity without the compassion of God, but owed by me and you and you and you, by all of us, by every man and woman and child who ever walked the earth. An eternity of suffering for each one of us and our sins. That's a billion eternities of separation from God's compassion, all at one time for all men. It would be done when this was completed. Not like the lamb, but like the true sacrifice of a perfect man who had never sinned, and all on Jesus for 3 straight hours. I have this picture of God the Father in my head, standing over his only begotten Son who kneels in front of him. God holds out his hand over the head of Jesus. And there's a clap of thunder. No, not thunder, more like an atomic bomb going off. And there's a huge lightning bolt in my mind that flashes between God's hand and the top of Jesus' bowed head. And Jesus writhes in pain and anguish. On his face there is fear and grief and disbelief and suffering. God does not flinch. He doesn't waver, but he steadfastly continues the administration of the punishment that you and I should be undergoing. Maybe this is stretching it too far, but I think there are tears in his eyes. I think there are tears rolling down his cheek. And yet he continues steadfastly. I think if he spoke any words, it would be something like, "This hurts me more than it does you," but he would be serious. All of the parents in this room know exactly what I'm talking about. I multiply it by a billion times. I see the Father's wrath poured out in righteousness on his own Son, because God's righteousness, his holiness, his justice must be fulfilled. Why? So that at the same time, his glory and his honor and his power and might and his grace and his mercy may be fulfilled as well. He has promised it. His nature will allow nothing less. It is the equation for atonement. It is the prescription for the salvation of the sinful children God loves, you and me. And then in verse 34, Jesus breaks his silence and he says something that makes us understand what definitely was going on with him right there. 34 says, "And at the ninth hour, Jesus cried with a loud voice, 'Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani?' Why have you forsaken me?" Does Jesus really think his loving Father has abandoned him, has left him? No, not at all. Not at all. Jesus doesn't think God departed. As a matter of fact, he knows better, all too well, better than anyone, that the Father is right there. After all, didn't the Father just administer billions and billions of eternities of punishment for your sins and mine on his own Son? Yes, the Father was still there. The Father was there. Here's the deal. Here's the big difference between Jesus and all those other people who had ever been crucified and ever were crucified afterwards. Jesus, the perfect Son of God, has for all time, for all eternity, has felt the compassion of God the Father. Right there with him. Jesus has never sinned against God. Therefore, he has never felt the wrath of God. He never has been without God's compassion until now. And so he naturally cries out, "My God, God, why have you forsaken me?" Mark doesn't recount the exact words, but we know Jesus speaks a declaration of covenantal certification here. With the words told to us in John's Gospel, we can see what Jesus says next is the ratification of a new covenant in blood with God. John 19:30 says, he said, "It is finished." And he bowed his head and he gave up his spirit. It is finished. Teleo. It is completed. It's a Greek bookkeeping term, meaning all debt and all income are in balance. In other words, the atonement's complete. The debt is completely satisfied. God is satisfied with the payment made by Jesus Christ for you and me of the debt that we owed him. He is satisfied. It is finished. Teleo. There's a whole sermon there. We're not going there because we'll be here till at least midnight and probably longer than that by the time we get John and Bobby and Davey and James and everybody else in this room who has something on their heart about this scripture. But we can't go there now. But look at this next line, 38. "And the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom." Do you see what that represents? At the very moment that Jesus yells out and explains to us that God's compassion, he can't feel it anymore, thereby the debt is finished. He says it is finished. The debt is paid. At that very moment, the curtain, immediately, completely, after Jesus' work on the cross, is torn from top to bottom. This is the curtain between the Holy of Holies and the Holies. It is the place that keeps man away from God's presence. It can only be gone into once a year by one man, and that is the chief priest. And he has to have a rope tied around his foot in case he didn't get rid of all of his sin, run in, do what he has to do, and run back out. If God struck him dead because he wasn't clean enough, they could pull him back out. He was a chief priest filled with sin. He was an imperfect priest. He was a man. He was imperfect. And so this curtain is torn immediately upon the completion of Jesus' work. So what does that mean to us? Well, it's clear that for all men now, all of us broken, sinful men, we can stand in the presence of a holy God. We could never do that before, not without being struck and dead. Struck dead. Now God, after this happens, well, we can do that. We can go stand before him. We're no longer separated by God's law. We're not separated by a priest. We are not separated by a curtain. We can now go stand before him, and God sees us according to the propitiation, the substitutionary sacrifice of that perfect lamb, that perfect man, that sinless man, that Jesus who just did his work on the cross. Because of his sacrifice offered once for all by our great new high priest according to the order of Melchizedek. Verse 39, "And when the centurion who stood facing him saw that in this way he breathed his last, he said, 'Truly, this man was the Son of God.'" What about you? Have you heard that this man, Jesus, was the Son of God and refused to believe it? Have you been told the truth about his work on this earth and rejected it? Have you seen the Son of God and not believed in him? Or have you, like the thief on the cross, turned from your sins, believed in the truth that Jesus is the Christ and has been and you have been granted eternal salvation and life? Fellow sinners, it is not too late to do that, not as long as you have breath in your lungs. Your sins are not too big for the Son of God. As a matter of fact, he's already done the work. He's already felt the pain. He's already paid the debt. All you have to do is believe in him. That's it. You just have to believe that he did that for you. That he was God and he could do it, and he did. He's already given us his promise. Jesus has given his word in his blood, and your redemption is sealed just by believing. Pray with me. Today, Father, like the thief on the cross, we humble ourselves before you, God. We repent of our sins. We put our trust and our faith in the precious atoning blood of our Savior, Jesus, your Son. We accept your offer of forgiveness, mercy, and grace, and we rejoice that we may now call ourselves your children. In the name of our one and only Christ, Jesus, we pray. Amen.